and radio. After a year of this, I was glad to get back to the theatre, and a brand new, very funny play by an unknown writer, the young Alan Ayckbourn. I laughed a good deal at the first read-through of Relatively Speaking, which was to become Alan's first commercially successful play. It had a small cast: Richard Briers, Jennifer Hillary, Celia Johnson, and myself. A complicated plot, and it was well directed by an irascible Nigel Patrick. In those days, playwrights were always coming up against the censor, and Alan had his share of problems with Relatively Speaking. There was a lot of worry about plays concerning older men and young girls. How the Lord Chamberlain's mind must have worked. He seemed particularly worried about the implication of sex in the afternoon. He thought that pretty dirty, unless the girls stayed overnight. Eventually it was all resolved to everyone's satisfaction, and off we went on tour. Celia in her little car, and me in mine. And we would fetch up in Newcastle or Edinburgh or wherever, and have some very jolly times. Touring can be great fun, especially when you're in a play which everyone adores and are greeted in every town by full houses. And there is always the chance that you might get some decent fishing in on the way between dates. By the time we opened in London at the Duke of York's Theatre in 1967, we had it as near right as we were going to get it, and were awarded by gales of laughter. Alan was on his way. After the Ayckbourn, I found myself playing George Riley in Tom Stoppard's Enter a Free Man, which opened at the St. Martin's Theatre in March 1968. It was another play about failure. As always with a Stoppard play, the talk was good. But in this case, the plot was fragile, and I had a good many problems with it. I don't think it quite worked as a stage play. However, it was the basis of a friendship with Tom, which lasted and which, 4 years later, led to me being offered the part of George Moore in Tom's amazing play, Jumpers. I had got to know Tom quite well and liked him enormously, discovering he was a keen fisherman and sharing a rod with him and his son Dickie on the Hampshire Avon. I was very excited when he sent me his new play, Jumpers, and offered me the leading role of George, a preoccupied professor of philosophy. The script was sent to me in 1971, when I was in Belgrade making a film. My heart sank when I read it. I was being offered this enormous part and felt sure the play was brilliant, but I just did not understand it. Being a bear of very small brain, I have occasionally turned work down because I don't understand the script. To my eternal shame, Peter Hall's production of Waiting for Godot was one of these casualties. But sometimes a part comes along which allows you to use all your eccentricities. And this, I recognised, was it. The first night of Jumpers was unbelievable, one of the highlights of my career. I had accepted the part on trust, and I had been right. The struggle for all of us in rehearsal had been long and hard, and when the first laughs came, early on in that first long soliloquy, the relief of finding it accessible to the public was enormous. After that, we flew. Recently, Maureen Lipman, who was understudying the part of Dotty, told me that her husband, Jack Rosenthal, who came to see the play that night, laughed so much he thought he was going to be seriously ill. The critics were delighted. Well, mostly. Michael Billington, writing in The Guardian, said, "Once or twice one of Stoppard's brilliantly coloured balls falls to the ground, partly because Michael Hordern's moral philosopher substitutes academic mannerism for apprehension of the argument. But this is not to deny that Hordern's simian habit of scratching his left ear lobe with his right hand, or leaning over his desk as if doing intellectual press-ups, is very funny to watch, or that he is brilliant at displaying cuckolded curiosity. Chompers won the Evening Standard Best Play Award, which appropriately was presented by Professor Sir Alfred Freddy Eyre, Wickham Professor of Logic at Oxford, who I think might have been on Tom's mind at the time he was writing this masterpiece. After Chompers had been so highly praised, Harold Hobson wrote, "To fail to enjoy it is not actually a criminal offence, but it is a sad evidence of illiteracy." The National Theatre, which according to journalists had been slumbering rather under the burgeoning oak tree of the Royal Shakespeare Theatre, regained some of its former confidence. They had been through a bad patch. Olivier said at the time, "We have to take risks. That is our job. But risks don't always come off. We were perhaps too ambitious. Now we have to be good boys. We are not really supposed to make money, but here we are in the rat race." We felt very virtuous that our efforts would perhaps help to change the run of bad luck which had been dogging our beautiful new controversial theatre. L'Étoile in Charlotte Street was Jonathan Miller's clever choice of venue for our first meeting in 1968. Clever because it was the perfect restaurant for me, eminently respectable, with a certain glamour and first-rate food. Jonathan, ever instinctive and sensitive to other people's eccentricities, had realised that I would be nervous about meeting this dangerously bejeaned radical, probably a communist, who might not be a gent, and whose satirical view of the world might be far from my own. The lunch was guarded and tentative to begin with, but after a good deal of splendid food and wine and Jonathan's wonderful wit, it ended with both of us helpless with laughter. Here began a personal and professional friendship, which was to be a great satisfaction to both of us. It was my first contact with Jonathan Miller, and very exciting it was. He was anxious for me to play the part of a professor of philosophy, an agnostic, who had no time for the supernatural, in a story for television called "Oh, Whistle and I'll Come to You," written by M.R. James from a collection of 19th century ghost stories. "Oh, Whistle" had an alarming effect on the viewing public, frightening the life out of everyone and making a huge impact. This was my first experience of working with Jonathan Miller, and luckily for me, it was not to be my last, as the following year, 1969, he again took me out to lunch and asked me whether I would play Lear for him at the Nottingham Playhouse. Lear was not something I had been planning to do all my life, but this is not a part that is offered every day of the week. And if someone comes up and asks, "Do you want to play King Lear?" you don't ask questions. I accepted immediately. We then got on with enjoying our meal and spoke no more about it. I had complete confidence in Jonathan and put myself totally in his hands. He produced the intellectual fuel for me to run on, although we didn't have any in-depth discussions about it beforehand. He did come down to Bagner for an evening, but we didn't go into Lear in any great detail. However, I realised, as we began rehearsals, that he had the most amazing grasp of the play, being not only a doctor, but versed in psychiatry. He was able to explain the whole geriatric aspect of the character, and he wanted me to play him very mad indeed. As Jonathan said in rehearsals, "It's a very ugly thing, madness. There is nothing pretty or prophetic about it." Working on Lear with Jonathan was one of the most exhilarating and funny experiences I've had in the theatre. His view was that if you didn't approach it as a funny play about people going gaga, you missed a dimension, and all you got at the end of the day was rather a depressing tragedy about madness and old age. You can't keep your intellect at a desperately elevated level all the time, and we laughed a good deal, at the same time working terribly well together. My having my feet on the ground was something he could use, while his intellect was something I could use. He is one of those directors who will take what you give him and use it. One night in 1968, before I had begun rehearsals for Lear, I was appearing in Peter Hall's production of Albee's A Delicate Balance at the Aldwych Theatre. John Gielgud came round to my dressing room one night after the show. I asked him if he had any advice or help which might get me through the run of Lear. "Yes," he replied. "Get yourself a small Cordelia." The decadent, hypocritical judge in Howard Barker's play Stripwell, which I played at the Royal Court in 1975, was a bit too close to my own personality for comfort. Plays and players found it muddled and unsure of what it was supposed to be doing, but playing a man racked by guilt, full of self-doubt and pessimism, I think that for me it was rather therapeutic. Eve and I were going through what is called a bumpy patch in our marriage. A long-suffering woman, she had finally put her foot down. I had been banished from the marital home, which by now was a small house with a dear little garden, goldfish and fountain, and peace. One of the goldfish was a savage brute. He ate the others, and we took him to the Serpentine. I wonder how many fish he ate there. I found myself living in a tiny flat just off Sloane Square, kindly lent to me by Michael Wilding, and absolutely jammed with furniture. I do a good deal of talking to myself when I'm alone, lots of small noises and grunts, ums and ahs, which is claimed to be the first sign of madness. I remember there was a very unpleasant upstairs neighbour who obviously was mad, constantly banging on the floor. Luckily, this unhappy situation came to an end. Eve forgave me my sins, and after a decent interval allowed me to come home. Thus, I look back on Stripwell with mixed feelings, although the critics were fairly kind to me. One of the great things about actors of a certain age is that if you can still stand up and remember your words, you're much better value than a younger man with lines on his face. I didn't have to think twice when, in 1976, Trevor Nunn asked me to have another go at The Tempest at Stratford, a few hundred yards from the bones of Shakespeare. Eve and I had had such a happy country summer at Stratford 20 years before, days on the river, picnics, fishing, Joanna playing with her friends in the garden, and we anticipated a repeat performance. This time we found ourselves a rather grand, bright, airy flat overlooking the river opposite the theatre in a part of the town called Waterside, and settled in nicely for the summer. I looked forward eagerly to confronting Prospero again. The Tempest was to be directed by Clifford Williams, with whom I soon realised I had very little rapport, finding him very hard work indeed. David Suchet was a splendid Caliban, covered in green makeup, and Ian Charlton's Ariel was a joy. His haunting singing of Guy Wolfenden's adaptation of Come Unto These Yellow Sands I shall never forget. But it was not the happy experience I had anticipated. After the first night, which I can't say was the greatest success of my career, but which went down reasonably well, Eve and I were taken out to an awkward, silent dinner by Terry Hands, who had obviously been instructed by Trevor Nunn to look after us. Don Amado in Love's Labour's Lost was a much happier experience, and I enjoyed myself thoroughly, teetering about the stage in a very camp, strange pair of shoes, the great stacked heels. In The Tempest, I made the acquaintance of Ruby Wax, who was being an outrageous nymph, and I fell madly in love with Zoe Wanamaker, who seemed to enjoy my company but didn't reciprocate my passion. Stratford was very different this second time round. I was almost the oldest member of the company, and working with a younger generation who had different attitudes and ways of working, I found it difficult. In the 1950s, the company was smaller, more intimate, and I was only at Stratford for 5 or 6 months. I don't think I'm a big company man, finding it difficult to accept the regimes and disciplines of a big company. The notice board, the company meetings and all that. Rather like being at school again, or finding oneself back in the Navy. I took advantage of the distinguished voice teacher they have at Stratford, Cecily Berry, but otherwise it was not an altogether happy experience. I think I'm what one might call a loner, which means I'm selfish and egocentric. Very loyal to the play I'm in, but not, as I say, a big company actor. After that deeply disappointing season at Stratford, I was thrilled when Granada Television offered me the chance of taking part in a series about that excellent fisherman and writer, Arthur Ransome, to be paid for doing what I most enjoy, fishing. The gods smiled on me again. The chief concern of the fisherman is to trick the fish out of the river. Fishing allows a man to recapture not only his youth, but the youth of the world. He is not moved by a primitive instinct for slaughter. If he were, he would satisfy it better with a hand grenade. These words of Arthur Ransome, from a series of essays about angling that he wrote in the 1920s for the Manchester Guardian, were later published in a book titled Rod and Line. Born in 1884, Ransome had a fascinating and eventful life, being a critic, an expert on folklore, a confidant of the Russian revolutionaries, one of whom he married, a war correspondent, the writer of Swallows and Amazons and other children's stories, and best of all, as far as I'm concerned, a learned, practiced, and witty fisherman. Angling has changed very much for the worse since Ransome's day, becoming a competitive sport with too many fishermen chasing too few fish. The really wild fishing, which Ransome knew, has virtually disappeared. Lightweight carbon fibre rods and nylon filament lines, instead of the old silk line and catgut cast we used, being much cheaper and stronger, have made fishing easier. Attitudes have changed, too. Actually, catching the fish used to be of secondary interest. What really mattered being the expertise required in presenting exactly the right fly to the fish. These days, an enormous amount of people have taken up fishing as a sport, and all they seem to want to do is catch the biggest fish possible. I've never caught a big trout. In fact, the biggest trout I ever caught was a brownie on the Kennet, weighing just over 3.5 pounds. Nowadays, stew-fed rainbows are put into reservoirs and fished out, weighing 15 pounds or more. This kind of fishing is of no interest to me. One might as well be playing ping-pong. So unnatural and so different is it from river fishing. Reservoirs do provide a lot of pleasure, but they give the false impression that weight and numbers, rather than a day's involvement, are what is important. The basic attraction of fishing is the hunting instinct, the man going out and bringing back the game to the cave. That must be why there are so few women who fish. Those who do, the Queen Mother, Diana Rigg, for example, tend to be rather good at it. It has been described as a Paleolithic life without the spur of Paleolithic hunger. it is hunting of a very refined nature. I caught this lovely trout, you boast. Aren't I clever? You recount the wonderful battle, the tremendous fight that must have lasted 10 minutes. In reality, it probably lasted 2, as it should, for you are there to get the fish on the bank, taking the shortest possible time about it to trick the dinner out of the water. Fishing is a deceptive activity. People tend to think of it as a relaxing business, that you spend most of your time patiently sitting with your feet up. Well, maybe, if you sit under a green umbrella by the side of a slow-flowing stream, or flinging a lugworm off the end of Brighton Pier, and wait for the bell to ring at the end of your rod. But fly fishing for trout requires constant awareness that action can be joined at any moment. Keyed up, full of tension, with a little bit of stage fright, you cannot relax and think about other things. Fishing wipes your brain clean, and you concentrate only on the fish. I have made the experiment of trying to do a fairly simple mental arithmetic sum whilst fishing. It cannot be done. Your concentration has to be absolute, and after a day at this intense concentration, I am whacked. You get to know trout individually in a river like the Lambourn. They are intelligent in an instinctive way. You get to know the one that lives behind that tussock of grass, and the one that always rises by that rock in the middle of the water. Then there is the one in that eddy, which is impossible to catch. You pit your wits against them. To win the first battle in this war between you and the fish, you must give him the fly he really wants. I use the black gnat as often as I use any fly in my box, sometimes tying my own. It's a bonus if you catch a fish on a fly you've tied yourself. One of the proudest achievements was the creation of a fly invented by me in a moment of dire need when materials for a pheasant-tailed nymph were unavailable and I improvised. It was a great success, and for some time was listed in that once famous Bible of fishing tackle, the Hardy Catalogue, under the artful name of the Hordern Nymph. This trout fly sold gratifyingly well for many years, and I was very miffed when it was eventually withdrawn from the catalogue. In fact, I've often wondered whether the Queen Mother, or a sympathetic fellow fisherman, might not have suggested my knighthood to soften the blow. The romantic vision of days spent fishing, delicious picnic hampers, wine cooling in a fast-moving stream, could not be further from the truth, as far as I am concerned. I don't drink alcohol when I am fishing, although I make up for this abstinence afterwards, as it blurs the edge of the enjoyment. I take a flask of tea and a boiled egg, which I often forget to eat, and find still in my fishing bag at the end of the day. At home, I fry the trout in a little butter, and eat with bread and butter, and a nice bottle of cold Chablis. Best of all is to cook the fish on the river bank by making a fire over a flat stone, then scraping off the ashes and cooking the fish on the piping hot stone. No knife and fork, fingers only. Delicious. But I digress, and return somewhat reluctantly here, as I did after fishing Ransom's rivers, to the world of theatre. 1983 was a strange, mixed sort of year. It began with a knighthood, which was a great thrill, and a great surprise to us all. Joanna, Eve and I put on our best togs and went to the palace to meet the Queen. Joanna's husband Fritz joined us later for a slap-up lunch. Joanna and Fritz had married the previous May at Chelsea Town Hall. We were and are very fond of Fritz, a charming, attractive young man who is the son of Sir Clifford Curzon, the concert pianist. To our great joy, we were not only celebrating my knighthood at that lunch, but also Joanna's pregnancy. Our first grandchild, Nicholas, was born on the 5th of September. Eve and I were very proud. The rest of the year was mainly taken up for me by being one of the awful absolutes in The Rivals at the National Theatre. What do you eat for breakfast? A boiled egg, usually. Yes. I thought you looked like a boiled egg man. Would you mind eating a boiled egg in the scene? In his review of The Rivals, Bernard Levin was kind enough to suggest that my egg-eating on stage might be a lesson to all students interested in the theatre as a career. I've always enjoyed eating on stage. All my theatrical life I have enjoyed dinner scenes, sitting round a table, timing one's laughs with food and drink, and properly eating, not just pushing the food around on the plate and nibbling. In fact, I think I enjoy eating on stage rather more than I enjoy eating off it. So when Peter Wood suggested the egg-eating in a scene between Sir Anthony Absolute and his son Jack, I jumped at the chance. Perversely, I was also frightened. I had never played in an 18th-century play or worn 18th-century costume before. Sheridan is late 18th century, of course, and hasn't got all those airs and graces, but the language is what you might call difficult. I have always been a quick study. I learn quickly, but not Sheridan. The writing is so convoluted, so intricately built, that if you make one slip, it throws you for the next passage. You can't improvise Sheridan. But I love the English language, and in the hands of our best poets and playwrights, it is so worth speaking and hearing. So, of course, I had to have a go. It was excitingly cast, with Geraldine McEwan as Mrs. Malaprop, Patrick Reichardt as my son, Jack Absolute, Edward Petherbridge, Falkland, and exciting new actress Fiona Shaw playing Julia. Tim Curry as Bob Akers, and Niall Buggy, Sir Lucius O'Trigger. It was during the run of The Rivals we heard the sad news that Ralph Richardson had died. At the end of the show, there was always a jolly dance on stage, with all of us jigging about, having a lovely time, the audience clapping and cheering. This night, after the usual 10 minutes of jollity, it was my task to walk to the front of the stage and to make the sad announcement. There was a gasp of shock, and I suppose disbelief. Ralph was so much part of theatrical tradition in this country, almost a landmark, like the Albert Memorial. The thought of his death was unthinkable. We were all terribly moved. After a minute's silence, the audience, who just before had been cheering and clapping, filed silent out of the Olivier Theatre. I went thoughtfully back to my dressing room. Ralph and I had never been close, though we had worked a good deal together. I had always been in awe and rather frightened of him, but I felt very sad at the thought of his demise, and was probably musing upon my own mortality, when fellow actor Patrick Reichardt came up to me and kindly said a complimentary word about my small speech of regret. I'm afraid I heard myself saying, from somewhere a long way away, I might get some decent parts now. It was during the run of The Rivals that Eve was taken very ill with a brain hemorrhage and had to lie absolutely still in hospital for 6 weeks. It was a worrying time. 3 years later, in the spring of 1986, I was filming in Berlin when I received an urgent message that Eve had been taken to hospital. She had been discovered unconscious on the floor of our London flat, having had a heart attack. She went into a coma, and on the 19th of April 1986, Eve died. I couldn't have understood all those years ago on our honeymoon train to Mein Turog, when I looked at her and thought, what have I done, that she would be my modus vivendi, to be there to say, this is a wonderful play, you must do it, or you were terrible tonight, what were you thinking of? When I came home from fishing, she would be there, to tell me how clever I was to catch such a splendid fish, or to console me when I hadn't. She kept me on balance when I was depressed or over-related, and I was so absolutely sure that I would go first that when she was no longer there, I was devastated. I have been a far from perfect husband and father. I'd shilly-shallied a bit all my life, being totally absorbed in my work and fishing, leaving Eve to cope with all the boring minutiae of real life, which she did beautifully. She had given up work to look after our daughter and our two homes, and I'm sorry she sacrificed her career for mine. When she died, my life fell apart, and I felt aimless. And as there had been a certain amount of infidelity on my part, I was filled with a good deal of remorse and guilt. I won't give a list of all the leading ladies I've been to bed with, but it does happen. Two main players in any piece do become close, and it is sometimes inevitable, if there is a mutual attraction. For things do get out of hand, and there has to be an understanding on both sides. But I am getting my comeuppance, because she has left me alone. And the curious thing is that if you have spent all your life trout fishing, as I have done, there really aren't many friends to see you into a happy old age. Now even the fishing has lost some of its charm. We buried Eve in the churchyard at Winterbourne, near our house at Bagnor, and planted an elm tree at the foot of her grave. 2 months later, Joanna and Fritz had their second child, a girl. They called her Eve. I fell to pieces when Eve died, and I'm afraid there was a good deal of public self-flagellation on my part. In interviews and occasional chat shows, I was very sorry for myself indeed. And I must say, I did find it very difficult to cope without her support. Domestically also, I was hopeless, and things fell apart. Gardens were not tended, keys forgotten, things rotted in fridges. I remember, on something like Desert Island Discs, giving my usual self-pitying song about being alone, and I happened to mention the terrible difficulties I had ironing shirts. For the next few weeks, letters flooded in from ladies, anxious for my well-being, offering advice, and sometimes even themselves. One lady even sent complicated diagrams showing me exactly how a shirt should be ironed. It was good of them, of course, but I felt unable to accept any of their kind offers. Eventually, with the help of Joanna and Fritz and kind friends, I managed to get myself back on a bit of an even keel and at least sort out a few practical things like gardens and houses. Rooms were redecorated. My friend Sheila Stiefel made me some nice curtains. And then Toby Robertson asked me to play William, the elderly, wise waiter in Shaw's You Never Can Tell. I went through my usual anguish about whether to take the part or not. It would be my first appearance in London since the Rivals in 1983, and I had been turning down offers from the theatre for quite a long time, having neither the will nor the inclination to work. But the part of William was too good to miss, and I decided to have a go. We opened in December 1987 at the Haymarket Theatre, the most beautiful and glamorous of theatres, to very decent reviews, although my wig got a good deal more attention than I felt it deserved. Said one, "This performance is handicapped by the worst wig on the West End stage since Charlton Heston's." We had a very respectable run. You always get good and bad audiences, though. And I have always believed that no matter how good or bad a play is, you usually run out of intelligent audiences after a certain period of time, people laughing when they shouldn't and keeping quiet when they ought to be laughing. Still, It was fun to do, and we all enjoyed ourselves. I was beginning to feel a little happier. I'm not generally keen on accepting a part in a long television series, as it can so easily limit any other kind of work you might want to do. Maigret, for instance, which I had been offered some years ago and turned down, almost did for poor Rupert Davis, who of course accepted and then found it difficult to move on to something else once it was over. Although the regular income from television would have been delightful, I'm glad now I turned Maigret down. Same goes for Doctor Who, although I think that might have been more in my range. Paradise Postponed, which we shot in 1984, was different. John Mortimer wrote the novel and the film script for Paradise Postponed almost simultaneously. John is a lively man, humble and funny, a marvellous word spinner. After a splendid meal at the Garrick, notice how many decisions I make after a splendid meal and some decent conversation, I was delighted when he asked me, quite properly, coming as I do from a long line of clerics, to play the part of the Reverend Simeon Simcox. I can remember feeling after the war that everything would be different, John has said since. Heaven and earth had opened for us a classless society. The question I ask is why then have we ended up with the same old rubbish? An enormously ambitious saga about the decline of middle-class life after the war, Paradise Postponed took almost a year to film. It had a 32-week film schedule and cost £6 million to make. It was to be shown in 11 episodes. I'm concentrating a good deal on television nowadays, generally finding myself playing an old person with other old people. In Kingsley Amis's play Ending Up, a depressing tale about a group of people attempting to live amicably together, John Mills and I calculated one day at an idle moment during rehearsals that the combined ages of the older members of the cast, Googie Withers, Lionel Jeffries, Wendy Hiller, and ourselves, came to nearly 400 years. The same with Memento Mori, a play about old age adapted from the novel by Muriel Spark, which has been shown twice on television and won an award. There we all are, octogenarians together. And now I have just filmed Middlemarch, adapted from the book by George Eliot, where I play most of my part dying in bed. Still, jolly nice to be able to go on working when you're in your 80s. And I must say, we all have a good time together, comparing symptoms of decrepitude. I enthrall them all with tales of my knee operation, the awful pain, how brave I was, and we swapped doctors' phone numbers. I have never regretted receiving no formal drama school training. It wouldn't have suited me at all. Earnest drama students and seekers after truth would have intimidated me terribly. Dazzled by their sophistication, I would have been terrified of being found out. Being self-taught, learning from other actors and directors, I am bored by the intellectual view of the theatre. Actually, it scares the shit out of me. My view being that an actor should learn the lines without too much cerebral interference. I think that a lot of actors are terribly precious, living in the unimportant enclosed world of theatre, theatre, theatre. And this doesn't make them better actors. Plays are about the world, about everybody. Neither am I interested in theories about acting. I love the English language. Our best poets and playwrights are so worth speaking and hearing. And when I think of some of the glorious speaking in Macbeth or King Lear, it brings tears to my eyes. You act for all you're worth, and this wonderful music comes out. Once you try and intellectualise and make it music, it doesn't work. I am a part actor, not a play actor, my job being to get into the mind of the character, even if I don't understand the play as a whole. Some of my performances were better than others. Some of those I thought were bloody good at the time, I now know were fairly disastrous. And I think, being the instinctive actor that I am, this must happen. But I enjoy acting enormously, and when each performance is over in the evening, I am probably not as critical as I should be, and I am certainly not good at taking criticism. Coming into the business comparatively late, I have always been completely without ambition or a career plan, except to get the next job and enjoy it. I like freedom of action, and if I were back at school now with the experience I have behind me, I wouldn't conform. I'd drop out and be a nuisance. The uncertainty of my profession, the wondering what you are going to do next, the variety, is all something I enjoy. I've been very lucky. I've kept in employment. I haven't had to worry too much about the telephone ringing. And at the risk of sounding rather bold, I haven't often backed away from a challenge, but was ready to play any old part that was going. Happy to play Toad one day, Lear the next, and Paddington Bear the day after that. Especially enjoying comedy. But if you ask, which do you prefer, tragedy or comedy, it's a bit like the difference between roast beef and meringue. Both delicious in their way, but there's nothing more satisfying than 1,000 people sharing their laughter with you. In my view, acting is a hang-up from childhood, changing into funny clothes, dressing up, and entering a world of make-believe. Not that this makes it disreputable. On the contrary, I think it is estimable, giving a great deal of pleasure to a great many people. But apart from being an evening's entertainment, I think it's transitory and rather unimportant. It may appear curious that someone like myself, who has so little time left, who has reached, as it were, the top of my profession, has so little good to say about it. Maybe, if I'd had more of a struggle, I would be more respectful of it. After all, it's been a satisfactory profession to me. In 1972, I was honoured with the CBE. Exeter and Warwick Universities have been kind enough to give me honorary degrees, and I am an honorary fellow of Queen Mary College, London. In 1980-81, I shared with Celia Johnson the Royal Television Society Programme Award for our work in The History Man. You're all right, how am I? And all's well that ends well. I was amazed, in a generation of such great classicists, to be honoured with a knighthood in 1983. When the letter came in the post, I was desperately embarrassed and still wonder, why me? A few days after the announcement, Judy Dench and Michael Williams sent me a box containing a bright red balloon which floated up to the ceiling and for weeks looked down at me saying, well done. Most recently, in 1988, Drama magazine gave me an award for, as they put it, my outstanding contribution to British theatre. Acting has brought me great joy and a good deal of material comfort, and it has brought me into a style of living, which isn't me at all. I love the country, and the reality of my life is to be found not so much behind the footlights as at the side of a river with a rod in my hand. If I hadn't had to earn my living, I would never have gone near London. You wouldn't be able to see me for dust and small stones. I would be off fishing. After all the great parts I have played in my career, Prospero, Lear, Sir Anthony Absolute, George in Jumpers, after the accolades, the CBE, knighthood, honorary degrees, mixing with the great and the good, I was brought down to earth recently by a small boy, whom I had noticed having an intense argument with two other small boys outside my phone box. I seemed to be the centre of discussion. When I stepped out of the box, one of the boys came up to me, looked up earnestly, and very politely asked, "Excuse me, aren't you Paddington?" I felt gratified.